Hello, welcome everyone to our next session in our Omics Basics series. This is the first of three sessions that are going to focus on omics applications, really specifically regarding humans. And our first in that series is going to be on human genetics and ancestry. And we have Dr. Tim O'Connor here to present on that today. And so I'll let Tim go ahead and introduce himself some more.
Thank you, Michelle. So like she said, I'm Tim O'Connor. I'm an associate professor at the Institute for Genome Sciences, and I also co-direct the program in health equity and population health. And in addition to a number of other affiliations, as you kind of accrue over time at University of Maryland. My primary area of research is in genetic epidemiology and population genetics, specifically for underrepresented populations around the globe. We've had a number of different applications of that. This presentation, my goal is to kind of have it be a mix of both kind of fundamental concepts in human genetics, specifically looking at things like association analyses and GWAS, but then also looking at things like population genetics and how we're all connected and what kind of information that might be able to tell us. So happy to take questions at the end. And with that, the general flow of this the way I've set this up is to introduce kind of the concept, maybe give a little bit of basic background, and then show you how we can actually apply it. So to start off, one of the keys to understanding how genetics relate to any given trait we might have in any given population is to do a genetic association. So as a background, I'm sure many of you are very familiar with the concept of a statistical association. This is correlated with that, all those kind of fun things. In a genetic association, what we're really looking at is kind of looking at a genetic variable, usually a specific variant of some kind, some sort of allele, where one person has an A or another person has a C at any given point in the genome, and seeing if that is associated with a health outcome or a trait. And so how do we do that? Well, we, in some of our kind of simplest ways, is we can group individuals based on cases and controls. So the example I'm going to use later on is actually Parkinson's disease. And so there you can include individuals that have Parkinson's disease and those individuals that may not have Parkinson's disease. And if we find that there are certain alleles that are more common in one of those groups versus another, versus your controls, then we might say, okay, this is associated, this is correlated with our disease outcome. And so we can actually develop statistical tests to see if that is a statistically significant difference. And typically how we do that is through logistic and continuous regression models. So in the case I just gave of Parkinson's versus not, we might use the logistic regression model up here. So you don't, this is math, there's no quiz, you're gonna be fine, everybody's gonna live. There's not a whole lot of math on in the presentation, at least what we'll be giving. But what you can see here is that, you know, you have some sort of intercept, some sort of average kind of log odds of a particular trait, for a risk for a trait. But the big question is there a correlation with one SNP or one genetic variant and whatever our outcome is? So are they correlated? Is this beta one significantly different from zero? The linear regression is essentially the same, but here we might be looking at something like height or LDL levels. And so here the outcome is just that value, sometimes with the transformation. But then also we're looking again for if that beta one, if this beta is statistically significantly different from zero, that could be less than zero, that could be greater than zero. We just wanna know if there's some level of correlation between this genetic variant and our trait of interest. Often we have to correct for a bunch of other covariates. So in the case of things like Parkinson's disease, we need to include things like age. Actually, sex is a key covariate there as well. And so we include those things to make sure that what we're seeing is a correlation over and above what we would expect, over and above that correlation with just our SNP included. So often when we're doing these kinds of associations, we think about them as kind of direct associations. This would be the case where this actual genetic variation, so in this case, a C to T variant at this part in the genome, is causally associated with our disease outcome. This is the ultimate goal of these kinds of studies, is to find what is the genetic variation that's actually causing this disease or increasing the risk of this particular disease. But usually, we don't have that direct access, or what we find may not be or needs additional evidence to be able to prove that it is the exact disease-causing variant. And so typically, we're working in this kind of indirect association type space. So if we want to think of outside of genetics, an example of indirect association, there's a strong correlation between how much soda you drink and whether you're going to get the flu. And the reason is because it's an indirect association. The indirect association is that you drink more soda during the summer, and you're also less likely to get the flu during the summer. So it's not really protecting you from the flu, but it's correlated. They're correlated with each other. And that's what we see here very often in the context of genetics. The disease variant might be in one point in the genome, and then physically connected to it on the same chromosome are other genetic variation that we might see and be able to observe at a much higher, with just, they might be included on whatever kind of study design we might be looking at. And that correlation caused by linkage disequilibrium is slowly broken down by what's called recombination. And so the further you get away from that disease variant, the more likely it is to have recombined and less likely you are to have seen the signal. And so these tagging variants will be located throughout the genome, and we might see a whole bunch of them hit that are all tightly correlated in one part of the genome. And that is basically what we're looking for, is to say, okay, this region is interesting. We don't know exactly which genetic variant might be causing the disease, but this region is interesting. This then gives rise to what are called genome-wide association studies. So here, rather than taking and doing a statistical test on just a single SNP, you're doing that same exact test over and over and over again, millions of times on all of the genetic variation that might be across the genome and that you might have access to across the genome. And this is what's called the Manhattan plot. And what you can see here is the reason why they call it a Manhattan plot is it's quote unquote looks like the skyline of Manhattan with these tall buildings, right? And so here we see this high increase. This is a negative log base of the p-value. And so we can see there's a whole cluster of genetic variants that are correlated with our trait, whatever it might be. So actual application of this. This is an example from a GWAS of Parkinson's disease in a Latin American group population. And what we can see is that for most of the genome, we don't see a lot of signal. We see kind of just noise. But at a couple of places, we see really strong evidence that there's some sort of association. This is what's known as genome-wide significant. This is we can thank Fisher for the 0.05, and this is a new threshold that's basically, you know, times 10 to the negative 7 or 8 is usually what we're using as a threshold. And so here, this SNCA gene is tightly, that has a lot of variants that are correlated with our disease of Parkinson's disease, and here we can actually zoom in on that particular region. So each of these dots here represents one statistical test of a SNP, and we can see they're colored based on how correlated they are with their linkage disequilibrium with each other. And it turns out we actually know quite a bit about this region. And this variant here, this, I'm not going to say the whole number, but this one with the purple diamond has a lot of evidence that's been building that this is the actual causal variant. And so it was on the particular chip that we were using, but these other SNPs are also being identified as correlated, and we can start to dig into what those things might mean. So how has this been applied? Well, so this is an infographic or a video from a few years ago now, 2019, where the EBI in the UK has collected all of the associations that's been found for so many different traits, 17 different categories of traits, So, and what they mean by categories is like LDL and HDL would be totally different traits, but they are both in the same category of lipids. And so I'm going to hit play here. And what you can see is that over the last, you know, couple of decades, we've started to see a lot of associations across the genome be built up for all these different types of traits. So each of these dots represents a different study that has found an association. And you can see that there's just this massive outpouring of information. We're starting to really understand what the different genetic variants mean, what they're associated with, how are they correlated or not correlated with specific traits. This is actually the current state. This is the one, this is the same website, but it's, you know, just the same present day. It doesn't look a whole lot different just because there's so much information going on here. And so as a result of this, we are starting to really understand different traits, what the genetic architecture of those traits are, how they're distributed across the genome, and what does that mean? Now we've kind of started to move into large-scale genomics projects, and we're starting to generate millions upon millions of individuals with sequencing data. The sequencing data is expensive, or at least it used to be expensive, but now that the prices have started to come down, we're starting to see hundreds of thousands of individuals. One of the projects that we'll talk a little bit about is the TopMed or Transomics for Precision Medicine project, where we're looking at 180,000 high coverage whole genomes with various different traits and different populations. And it's a pretty fascinating study. So what can we do with all of this information? Well, my talk was a little bit about, you know, human genetics, but that's a very broad concept. I'm glad there's two additional speakers that are going to be able to fill in some of the huge gaps that I left. I'm only talking about very fine, you know, very small number of aspects of human genetics. But we can start to do a lot with all of this data. One of them is to, and we'll talk about this, is to look at ancestry proportions. Not advocating for one company or another, but 23andMe or Ancestry DNA, if you send off your data to them, they come back with some proportion of ancestry. And we can talk a little bit about how that gets applied in kind of my world. We'll also talk a little bit about local ancestry. So moving beyond these kind of genome-wide estimates and start to say, well, at this particular location in the genome, what type of ancestry does this person have? One of the areas that we have been focused on in my group quite recently is looking at Latin American individuals and kind of filling in gaps, huge gaps in resources that are genetic resources that are available for those individuals. And then finally, we'll talk a little bit about how genetic information can tell us about demographics and or how demographics can affect genetic variation and how we are related to one another. So one of the motivations for looking at Latin American studies is that they have just not been included in most genome-wide association studies. So this is actually a little bit old. And at this point, it was about 1.3% of all individuals that had been included in genome-wide association studies were from Latin America. This has actually gotten worse lately, because with the advent of these huge, large biobanks, one of which is the UK biobank, there's been a kind of a resurgence of emphasis on European ancestry individuals. And so this number is out now less than 0.5%, just because there's been so much emphasis on some of these large biobanks, which is good. It's great for the science to be advancing. But as of yet, there's not a biobank within Latin America. One of the things that kind of happened during COVID times is, you know, we stopped being able to kind of mail samples. People weren't able to go out to the field. We weren't able to really kind of do a number of different things that we were originally planning. And so I was sitting back thinking, well, what can I do? What would be interesting? And I was like, well, I've got a lot of time on my hands, so I'm just going to start applying for any data sets that's out there. There's a lot of genetic data sets that are already published. There's a Like I said, there's hundreds of millions of individuals that have been genotyped or sequenced. And so we used this concept of gleaning. This is a fairly famous painting of a couple of people out in the fields gleaning. And in this application, right, they're looking for kind of what are the usable pieces of the crops after the main harvest has gone through. And so to kind of parallel that, what are the useful samples? Where are Latin American samples after these huge 100,000 individuals have gone through? Because they're often removed as not being, quote, homogeneous with the main population. And so turns out that, you know, tens of millions of participants, even if it's only 1% are Latin America, that means we've already genotyped hundreds of thousands of individuals. We just have to put them all together. We have to go through these individual studies and find those that are present already and pull them together. And so that's what we've done in a project that we call GLAD, or the Genetics of Latin American Diversity. The reason why we're doing this, like I mentioned, is to address the issue of a lack of biobank scale resources in Latin America. There are a few projects coming online soon, but the question of how available they will be is still up in the air. But then we also can start to ask questions of, well, are there certain parts of Latin America that are better represented than others? How well are Indigenous American ancestry represented within Latin America and beyond? And then finally, how do we make it so that all of this time of gleaning does not have to be done by every other person that ever wants to use this data? How do we make this into a useful resource? And I'll tell you that the process of gleaning in this context was a lot. We ended up applying for over 200 different studies. They all have various different application procedures and things that have to get signed, and it was a bureaucratic maze. I kind of turned it into a game in my head, and so that made it enjoyable and I didn't go insane. And also the final product I'm very proud of. Another reason that we're motivated to work in Latin America is that if you say Latinx or Latino or Latina, or I tend to use the word Latin American or Hispanic, these actually are heterogeneous. This is not just a group. This is each population has been kind of defined by various different demographic forces. How did that population get formed in the last 15 or 20 generations? And so here, this is actually a study from 2012, doing that admixture type analysis that I was alluding to before, where each individual is represented by a column. This is a stacked bar plot. And so each individual, that the amount of variation that they have that's close to Indigenous American is colored in red. The amount for African ancestry is colored in green, and blue represents European ancestry. And so you can look at, say, okay, let's look at this Dominican. This is, you know, individuals that are Dominican. And it turns out they have primarily European and African ancestry with a little bit of Indigenous American ancestry. But whereas if we look at Mexico, there's a huge amount of variation, both within Mexico, but also compared to other places in the globe. And this is an example of where this label, this ethnicity label, is a social construct. It's not something based on biology. Each individual has their ancestors, and where did they come from? Do they have slave ancestors? Do they have European ancestors? Do they have Indigenous American ancestors? Do they have a combination of all? And this then creates a unique profile for each of them. And so this creates a challenge, but also an opportunity, because it means we can start to study genetic variation from the globe within one group, within this part of the world, within Latin America. Another reason that we are interested, this is actually based on ancient DNA data. So these green dots that you can see here, these green triangles, represent an ancient sample. So in this case, it was almost 6,000 years before present. This was, you know, 85,000 years before present, almost 8,000 years before present. But what you'll notice is that over the course, so when we're looking at modern day populations, which is what you're seeing in these circles, it turns out that those populations that geographically live closest to these triangles still retain the closest amount of relationship with those ancient samples. This is actually very different than what we observe in Europe. So in Europe, there's a lot of movement. Charlemagne came around, did a whole bunch of movement of people. But in Latin America, or at least within the indigenous American kind of community or ancestry, the current model that we have is that roughly speaking, 16,000 years ago, they left the Bering Strait. They left Alaska and started to spread. And within about 2,000 years, they covered both North and South America, and then they stayed put, and they didn't actually mix very much. And so this is fairly unique, meaning in some studies that we've done in Peru, geographically very close populations are, they still go back 10,000 years before they connect. Whereas how far they go back to connect to those that are in North America is still about 10,000 years. So it really is this kind of big branching and migration across North and South America. And so what that means is if we only study Latin American individuals from Mexico, their indigenous American component will only be representative of Mexico. It won't be something we can generalize to the kind of the rest of Latin America. So we really do need good representation across the board. Okay, so what are our long-term goals? We want to collect as much genomic information as possible for Latin Americans. If you know of a study that you think we've missed, we're constantly looking for more studies to include, and I'm happy to fill out any paperwork that's necessary. We want to make this available to the scientific community while still preserving individuals' consents and rights. We don't want to be exploiting these samples. We want to make sure that all that paperwork that I sign saying I won't distribute this data, I'm signing it truthfully. But we still want to make it useful and available. And one of the chief ways that we can kind of do that is through providing controls for other Latin American studies, right? If you've got a limited amount of money and you can say, well, we can sequence 10,000. If you sequence 10,000 of your cases, we can find matching controls within our data set. And we'll talk a little bit in detail about how we might do that. But then the other thing is that we're going to create a biobank, but it's going to be kind of a hodgepodge origin. So one of the ways that we can use to combine this data is through a process called imputation. So this is a kind of an ongoing, really important step in a lot of genetic studies, is you might have a GWAS array. So this might sample anywhere from 500,000 genetic variants across the genome to 5 million. I don't know, Ram, you're here, you probably know more. The largest chip you've seen is probably 5 million, 10? Yeah, about 5 million, okay. So, which is a really good representation, but there's a lot of genetic variants that are missed, that are kind of found within or between the different ones that are included on these chips. And so through imputation, we can actually start to fill in some of those gaps. So this process requires a large repository or reference population. The one that we're going to use later on is through TopMed. This has 90,000 individuals included from a whole host of different backgrounds. And from that, we can identify kind of different haplotypes that exist, different combinations of genetic variants. And using that, we can take a data set where there's some missing. So these are all question marks in this little blue box here. And we could say, well, we know what the genetic variant is in this white box, but we don't know what it is in this little bluish box. So can we use that correlation between markers, that linkage disequilibrium, to start filling in those gaps? And what we do is we then look it up and say, okay, well, we've got this series of things that we do know. How similar is that to the haplotypes in our reference population? And using that, we can start to say, well, this variant is going to be more likely for that individual at that site than this other variant. And we can start to fill in the gaps with kind of varying amounts of confidence. So that's just what we did. So roughly half of the data that we were able to gather glean for the GLAAD project came from this chip study design, where they've got a number of different places, but a lot of it's missing. And some of them are quite old chips. So they're more on that 500,000 SNP range compared to the 5 million SNP range. And so after looking through well over 300,000 genomes to find Latinos or putative Latinos, Latin American samples, we ended up with our first kind of data freeze of about 61,000 individuals. This gets reduced a little bit down when we start to remove and start to only include individuals that are not closely related to one another. So we remove things like parent-child in comparisons. We only keep one of the pair, or even first cousins. We would only keep one of the two. And that ends up with about 50,000 individuals. And so we identified them through two means. One was through kind of self-described data. This person labeled themselves as Hispanic Latino, or they labeled themselves as being from Mexico. But then we also used a different way with using that admixture proportions and said, anybody that has some amount of measurable Indigenous American ancestry, we also want to include them. We kept that label, especially if we didn't know how they would self-describe, just because the way that that sample was collected was very, very different, rather than having it be something that's self-described. So we always keep that in the back of our minds on some of these studies. We use that TopMed reference, that 90,000 individuals as a reference, and we took each individual data set and we imputed it against TopMed. When we then got all of the variation out, the only ones that we kept were the ones that were high confidence in every single data set we looked at. So if it was low quality in one data set and high quality in all the rest, that variant was removed. So we were very conservative in terms of which SNPs that we kept or which genetic variants we kept. In this case, I'm saying that we ended up finding about 9.1 million variants that were imputed. But this is actually using a fairly low threshold of 0.3. So they're correlated with about 0.3. The following analyses that you'll see, we retained all of those that were found to be above 0.9 in each data set. And that was a very conservative kind of trying to focus in on what is the highest quality data that we have and what kind of analyses can we do with that. So one of our first analyses that we use both in genetic epidemiology, but also in population genetics and in a host of other types of applications is something called principal component analysis. This is a method that's over 100 years old now. We're not going to go again through all the fancy math to make it work. But basically what it does is it takes something like this. So here is a list of the first 100 genetic variants out of 10,000 that were simulated. They could have an individual could have 0, 1, or 2 copies of some allele at that particular variant. And a line represents an individual as it goes across this whole thing. And so it's really hard to see kind of what's the overall pattern going on. It's quite confusing. And so dimensionality reduction takes this 10,000 variables, and in this case, reduces it down to 2, and 2 principal axes of variation. So in this case, we've got PC1, where it's explaining 19% of this original data. PC2 is explaining 13%. And we can start to see some individual clusters. We start to see a blue cluster and a red cluster. And some of these other clusters are kind of intermediate between things. And we can use it to start understanding what is the overall structure of this entire data set. And it turns out when we apply this to humans, we can start to understand both things like biogeography. One of the first uses of this was actually showing this in Europeans and showed that you could create a map of where people were from. And it looked like the map of Europe, like it even followed some of the same contours and everything. It really captures biogeography quite well. When we apply this to our GLAD data set, we can start to see that there are kind of 3 main axes of variation. So this is 3 PCs. There's actually quite a few more. But the first PC here is separating individuals of African ancestry from those that don't have African ancestry or have less African ancestry. PC2 is right here on the y-axis, and it is separating individuals with Indigenous American ancestry. So here, this brown here are individuals from Peru. I believe that color is actually called Lima because they're from Lima. have to use it, right? You know. And it's so, you know, this there's a lot of Indigenous American ancestry going here. And then PC3 is actually separating out East Asian and South Asians into another group. If I was to look at PC4, I believe that it separates out South Asians from East Asian. And to be clear, though, traditionally, So this gets on kind of this concept of continental ancestry versus race versus genetics and genetic ancestry. Often we kind of ascribe to this idea of, well, if we take all of these colored dots, and these colored dots come from a project called the Thousand Genomes Project. It did a great job of trying to sample from all over the globe, but it turns out that it sampled from very discrete points all over the globe. And so if you sample discretely, it turns out you get discrete representation. GLAAD was not sampled in that way. We tried to take anyone that was self-described as Latino or from Latin America, and that's what we see in the gray dots. And you can start to see that everybody is kind of everywhere in this tree, that there's a continuous amount of variation, a continuous amount of ancestry. And so saying that this is a group just doesn't work when you start to look at genetics in this way. And so if you only look at the colors, you might get this misnomer that populations are discrete, but it really comes down to how were they sampled. If you sample from, you know, randomly across any given region, you're going to realize that it's fairly continuous. We don't move around a whole lot. People tend to not move around a whole lot. This is always a statistic that throws off us academics, but the average person lives within 10 miles of their mother. And some live much, much closer. So it's not unusual for even within a city to be able to see discrete groups or this pattern, which is pretty fantastic. So another way of projecting this data through a different type of dimensionality reduction technique is something called UMAP. And so here, what we do is we take those principal components. This is just the first two principal components of GLAAD here on the top. And then we took the first 10 principal components and projected them onto this two-dimensional space. So we cluster them in this 10-dimensional space, and then we try to project that down onto two dimensions just graphically. So now it looks kind of like a frog, with our little frog legs, but it actually can start to give us some insights into different patterns of genetic variation, different patterns of ancestry. So here we've colored it now based on their percentage of African, European, or Indigenous American ancestry. And what we can see here is, you know, this leg, the right leg here seems to be those of more African ancestry. The main body here seems to be of European ancestry. And that left leg seems to be of Indigenous American ancestry. And when we blow that up, we can actually start to see some subtle patterns and differences that we were trying to get at when we were talking about different indigenous groups. So over here is Peru, down this green line here are individuals from Guatemala, this kind of dotted line here are individuals from Mexico. And then there's these individuals down here that were self-described as Indigenous American individuals. And so we're starting to get even fine scale patterns so that we're not even just finding Indigenous American ancestry, but Peruvian ancestry and Guatemalan ancestry and Mexican ancestry, which is pretty cool. We can also use it to help us make sure that we're not doing something wrong in the way that we analyze the data. So here I briefly mentioned that admixture defined individuals, those that had a little bit of Indigenous American ancestry estimated compared to those that were self-described, and they overlap quite a bit. We're constantly refining how we're going to include or not include individuals where we don't have self-described information. It's not they self-described as this, but we think it's that. We just don't have the information. It's either lost or just wasn't in the databases that we had access to. And so we don't want to just throw all of that data out. We want to try and make as much useful use of it as we can. And it turns out that they seem to overlap pretty well, that we're actually getting pretty good matching, that, you know, if they have some amount of Indigenous American ancestry, they're similar to other people that were self-described as Latin American. The next type of kind of ancestry analysis that we can do is local ancestry. So here we're taking a single individual. So in this case, this is actually an African American individual. And we're trying to model where in the genome they have African haplotypes, where in their genome do they have European haplotypes, where do different parts of the genome come from. So here, each of these lines represents one of their two chromosomes. So, you know, there's two lines here for chromosome one, two chromosomes, twos, you know, everybody's got one from mom and one from dad. And so you can see that at various different points, this individual either is homozygous, they're the same ancestry on both copies, or they might be heterozygous, where one of their copies from one of their parents was European, whereas the other one is African. And this comes through kind of this process of admixture. So 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue, good old, you know, fourth grade rhyme that we use to try and understand history. And unfortunately, though, the negative side of this is through forced migration and other types of kind of colonialism, Latin American populations are a mix of African, you know, formerly slaves. They might be a mix of those that were subjugated as indigenous Americans. And then also those kind of European individuals came and influenced and spread their genes. And so we can see that there's kind of this diversity both across Latin America, but then also within an individual. This here is a graphic where we're going to take 1,000 individuals that are self-described as Latin American. I've ordered them by their percentage of indigenous American ancestry. So this is just a histogram of their indigenous American ancestry. And as we go from left to right, what you'll notice is, so right now, this individual is predominantly African with it being colored blue. A little bit of European colored here in red, and then yellow will be our indigenous American ancestry for this graphic. And you'll see that it starts to come up. Now, this is a little bit older, so we have a few gaps still in our data, but we've actually filled these in since then. But I like this graphic because as you start going from left to right, you start to see, okay, there's not really any kind of rhyme or reason. Any given part of the genome might be very different for the different ancestries. And so each individual is not just unique in terms of who their grandparents were and great-great-grandparents were and contributed ancestry from all over the globe. It also could be different from one sibling to another in terms of where in their genome they have African, European, or indigenous American ancestry. And so we need to start thinking about these kind of unique traits when we're thinking about going back to the association analyses, but also understanding where this genetic variation is and what its background is. All right. Sorry, I'm losing my throat a little bit. That's all right. We're going to start talking about something I really enjoy. So another way we can use this genetic information is something called identity by descent, or IBD. And basically what this is if you have some common ancestor in the past, so in this case, it was a grandfather, that grandfather passes on this red chromosome, recombination takes place, which is this combining of these two. So there was the gamete was formed by taking this part of the red chromosome and this part of this whatever color per chromosome it is and passing that on to one sibling, this or one child, and then passed on the full red chromosome to another child. And then these children get married, have their own offspring, and these first cousins now share this one segment here in red. They might share others, I haven't really looked, but this red segment comes from that single grandfather. So this has two pieces that are kind of coming together. One, it's finding very distantly related cousins. We can find, basically we can use this to understand how people are related over the course of the last 100 generations. This is the last 3,000, roughly speaking, about 3,000 years. But we can also, so we can find out how they're connected, but we can also then look at it at kind of a population scale. And then the other thing we can do is based on the size of the segments that they share, this can tell us about how distant their common ancestors were. If it's only a very small fragment, then it's likely that it was a much more distant ancestor. If it's a whole chromosome, it's probably more likely that they're siblings or parent offspring, right? That there's it can get, you know, the bigger the segment, the closer the relationship, the smaller the segment, the further away. When we do this on our population scale, when we're looking at our GLAD individuals again, we start to identify structure within our data that corresponds to this cousin structure of the last 3,000 years. And so, you know, here you can, it's a little bit difficult to see. I'll zoom in on this section in just a second, but basically we can start to see some very large clusters. So here, this is a group from Brazil. This is a group that seems to be coming from Mexico. The way that you read this is the darker the color, the more closely related those two individuals are. And then we've ordered them based on how closely related they are. And so it turns out like here, these are all individuals that are part of a single cluster that we identify. They all have similar ethnicity, and they also seem to be describing as coming from similar countries. When we zoom in here, we can start to see we're actually getting into very fine scale. These are individuals from Peru. This is a group from Costa Rica. This is actually a family study. So they're actually quite closely related to one another. Here's a few individuals from Guatemala. Here's Mexico, but they're actually, we labeled it as US Mexico because some of them are coming from places like Texas or California or New York, but they describe themselves as having Mexican heritage. But then others are directly from Mexico. Or not labeled, we didn't know beforehand where they would fit into all of this stuff. And so we can start to get very fine scale structure and looking at what is the kind of how these haplotypes are distributed in the last 3,000 years. We can use other clustering techniques. So this is a process called InfoMap. I really like this slide because it looks like a big celebration. It's a bunch of fireworks, and that's what we should be doing is we should be celebrating diversity. But that's exactly what we're seeing here, right? Is we've got Costa Rica up here as one cluster. We've got clusters from the Dominican Republic, Puerto Rico, and so on. There's lots of different kind of groups that where we can start to identify, okay, this cluster, they all seem to kind of share certain haplotypes in common, or they tend to share more common with each other than they do with other groups. And turns out that half of them are labeled as coming from Mexico. And so we can say, oh, well, this is probably a group coming from Mexico, which is pretty cool. This is another way of kind of looking at that. So the way that this method works is it actually identifies these clusters. And then this is showing, that's what we're seeing here on the x-axis is a whole bunch of the different clusters. In this case, they're called communities. And then we can see, okay, how enriched are they? What percentage of them have a label from one place or another in the world? And we can see that there's actually quite tight clustering of specific groups, which is pretty neat. The largest cluster turns out to be Puerto Rico. And this kind of makes sense because there's a lot of large studies that we included from Puerto Rico, but then also we included a lot of individuals from New York. There's quite a bit of Puerto Ricans from New York. And it turns out there's a lot of Puerto Ricans in Hawaii. I didn't know this. Something I learned. I have some slides at the end after everything is done, if you're interested, but we actually looked at like this relationship of Hawaii and Puerto Rico and New York. It's pretty cool. All right. How do we make this useful? How do we make this available to people? Because like I said, there's this huge amount of paperwork and nobody wants to fill out, or at least nobody wants to fill out again. And so what we can do is try to find ways of using these types of projections, like a principal component analysis, to abstract away the individual level data, the individual level genotypes, so that you can't know, okay, here's my individual. I don't know what genotypes they are, but I know where they fit into this principal component space. And so through that, what we can do is take external examples, we can project them onto our space, and then we can say, well, let's look in all of our space to find those that are going to be the closest matches. We find that collection that are the closest matches that are not going to create some sort of big structure between the two data sets. And we report back their allele frequencies. So again, you don't know anybody in our data set what their individual genotypes are. You just know what it is collectively. But for a group that's very genetically similar, has similar ancestry to your study of interest. So the way we evaluate this is through something called genomic control. This goes back to this idea of a genome-wide association study. And basically it's saying, you know, we expect to see the p-values to kind of follow along this diagonal line. This is the expected versus the observed p-values. And a good study that's well-controlled for population structure would be about one. The statistic would be about one. It would fall on this line. A bad one would be much, much larger than one. And so as we go through and look for matches or potential matches for this particular cohort of cases, we want to make sure that we're getting into this good range, not this bad range. Or if we are falling into a bad range, we want to know why. So to do that, like I said, we take this query data set. So you might have 1,000 cases of Parkinson's disease or stroke or whatever your, you know, your trait of interest is. It gets projected onto the GLADdB's space. From that, we start off by finding those samples in GLAD that are the nearest neighbors to those that are in your query data set. But then we don't stop there. That would be kind of the first simplest approach, but that may not be the best. You know, like we're working on a large parameter space here. And so we want to actually explore that space a little bit before, but we start there. And then we use a procedure called simulated annealing, where we take those samples, we replace them with other samples that seem to be a little bit better or a little bit worse, or, you know, remove those that are a little bit worse. And slowly we kind of jiggle the data set until we find a match that is as optimal as possible to that query data set. And from that, we can then report back those results as, like I said, as allele frequencies. So again, we're not revealing anybody's individual level data. So how well does it do? We did it on a number of different studies. These numbers are really small. For the most part, they are sitting under one. So this greedy, what I mean by greedy bipartite, is this first match here. That's what this is called, is a greedy bipartite matching. In our simulated annealing, here's on the bottom. And what we find is we actually get slightly better results. So here, like a good example here, this sigma cohort is a diabetes cohort from Mexico. Here, you know, the genomic control is 1.07 and we got 1.05. Right? So we're getting slightly better. There's always room for improvement, but we started to get a much better result. Or we can look at this large PD. This is the Parkinson's disease cohort that I mentioned earlier. With the greedy approach, it's 1.02. But with our simulated annealing, we're getting it much, much closer to one. And this is a particularly difficult data set because it was sampled from multiple places in South America all at once. And so I actually feel really good about how well it performed. When you compare them on average between the two, we did it on a number of different data sets. So here's the performance on the simulated annealing, and this is the performance on the kind of greedy matching. We find that it ends up falling below this X equals Y line, indicating that we're getting lower genomic control values, which is what we would expect. So we've made GLAD available as a database, or as a website. It can you do a couple of different things as part of it. It can do what we just described, where you can find genomic controls, and you can project your data, but it can also do data visualization. So we've taken all of this data and you can actually explore the principal component space or the UMAP space. So here, you know, here's the principal component space. This is a previous version of the UMAP projection. So you can look at that space. You can look at it by cohort. So you can say, well, I don't want to go through the procedure of applying for 200 data sets, but I think this cohort might match mine really well. So you can use it to say, well, I want to know what that cohort looks like in terms of if it's projection. And you can say, okay, that seems to match where mine are. So I'm going to go and apply for that one data set. You can even get down to the individual level in terms of where those individuals were sampled from, what information we know about them, whether they were self-described as Latino or they were admixture defined and so on. So this is at glad.igs.umaryland.edu. I don't know if it's up right today, but I think it is. If you're running into problems getting access to it, please let me know. Like I said, it has both the procedures of taking your data and processing it so that you can actually submit it and find matches, but then also the data visualization. So to pull this all together, we talked a little bit about association analysis as genetic variation is a powerful tool. Genomic resources have exploded and are only increasing. Some of these large pharmaceutical companies are sequencing millions of individuals a year now, tens of thousands of individuals a month, which is pretty astronomical. The GLAD data set, we have started to put together. We've kind of gotten to that first freeze. We've submitted a manuscript based on it, but any additional data sets that you guys know of or run across, please let me know. We'd be happy to work with anyone to try and make this as comprehensive as we possibly can and really fill in a lot of the gaps that we still see that it, within our data set. And then we talked a little bit about using some various different methods such as PCA or IBD and local ancestry to start understanding things that have happened over the course of the last little while and really understand the structure of our data. With that, I'd like to acknowledge my group who have been heroes in dealing with all of this very complicated data, messy data that they've had to try and combine, and they've done an excellent job of doing that. A number of other collaborators that have either given data or given advice on how to proceed with this. Obviously, our funding resources, my group. And then finally, another acknowledgement of, you know, this is these are all individuals that are on the submission of this paper because they all had various different aspects and contributions to the project. And so with that, I would want to thank the participants who've ever participated that are Latin American, that participated in genomic research, because without that, we wouldn't have any of this kind of, and so we need to continue to build relationships with those communities so we can get better resources there as well. With that, any questions?
So you need country of origin?
No. Like that's where we're saying with the admixture defined is that we don't have their country of origin.
No, you don't. But I think going forward, let's say I'm doing genetic testing, right? So I'd ask for ancestry, but I do not ask for them.
Mm-hmm.
So I should be asking. That's the
Yes, you're right. There's more information there than just Latin American. Yeah.
Kind of the opposite of what people used to say, that, you know, country of origin doesn't tell you.
Yeah, no, it really does. Especially, it's especially true in Latin America, just because there's so many different histories in different places. So one of my favorite examples is a group called the Garifuna who live in Honduras. And if you look at their ancestry proportions, they have almost no European contribution. They have some Native American or Indigenous American ancestry and a lot of African ancestry. And what it turns out is that particular group comes from one ship that came over forced through the slave trade, where the slaves revolted and won. And then they ended up on an island with some Indigenous American individuals and started living there. And so they have almost no European contribution at all. And so it's just a very different dynamic, and it's all due to this kind of demographic history of what happened for that group of people. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. He was asking about whether we should include country of origin in kind of when we take kind of information about individuals that are coming into genetic studies. Yeah. Any questionnaires?
Of the ancestry, are there standardized questions that researchers can use?
So the question is, are there any standardized questionnaires that people can use for these kinds of studies? So we were the opposite. We were the recipients of a whole bunch of different people's attempts to do this, and just trying to harmonize it was months of work to try and kind of, you know, what is one, you know, we have some individuals where we know the exact city that their grandparents came from, and we have other individuals we have no idea where they came from. And so there's a lot of different ways. I probably have opinions about it, but I don't have a specific questionnaire. And this was all retrospective, right? So we were going to existing data sets, and some of these are data that are 10 or 15 years old. And so we just had to hope that they asked the right questions or had the right kind of data that we could use. From the census? Yeah. But the census is also really bad because, one, it uses really horrible terms. And then, two, it uses very broad categorizations. And kind of like what we described, you know, Black, white, Latin American, like those are such crude terms that they don't really capture what's going on. And they're really going to miss a lot. And so the way I would do it, when we do it with population genetics kind of studies, often we want to know where people's grandparents are from. That's what we're interested in. If they have all four of their grandparents from a single city, then we can say something very definitive about that particular individual.
So are you going to try to, so this is all retrospective data. Are you collecting any prospective data to actually?
You going to give me some money to do some prospective data? I'd love to. Mostly we've been doing it through collaboration. So by prospective data, I know of data sets that are being created that we have a network of and collaborations with where we will then eventually include it in this study. But the primary sampling is not for GLAAD.
But can you get those
out? Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I mean, this...
Not just the data, but the actual sample.
Oh, the DNA samples? Yes, we could. I think that's part of a different kind of conversation, but yes, we have gotten, yes, we like I said, this was born out of COVID times, but we have other projects where we're actively sequencing and sampling.
No, because you've been creating such a physical thing for future research.
Yes, so the point I would actually, the place I would point it to is a guy named Carlos Bustamante, who's a huge name in population genetics. And he recently told me that his job now is to watch freezers. And basically he has a huge freezer farm full of individuals from all over Latin America.
So I have a question in the chat, which I think is related to the discussion you were just having, but I'll go ahead and ask it just to make sure. So after matching, so I think they mean, you know, your GLAAD tool, how can the research team access the matched samples? So I don't know if they mean the actual physical samples or the data sets.
Right. So we return a VCF file. So this is a variant call format file. It's a common genomic file format where it gives you at any given genetic marker that we deem has passed all of our quality control, the number of genotypes of the whole collective group. So it's not going to give you an individual sample, but it can say, okay, you know, out of the 1,000 individuals that matched, 500 of them have just the reference. Another, you know, quarter have, you know, or, you know, another 300,000. I don't know. I'm trying to think of what's going to be in Hardy Weinberg, but don't test me on whether it's in Hardy Weinberg. But like, if it's like 300, you know, the next 300 or three, how many did I say? 1,000. Next 300 have 1A and 1C. Or have one alternate and one reference, and then the remaining have all alternate. And so you can use that to go directly into an association test. It's a little bit different in that you won't have covariates, but we have a couple of different ways to try and get around that. One is through the direct matching. The matching procedure itself will hopefully mitigate the need for covariates. But then also, like if I'm going in and I say, okay, I have a whole bunch of Parkinson's individuals, I'm going to exclude those that were sampled as being cases and controls for Parkinson's, and they will never be possible matches. And so then you get the remaining data sets will come back and you'll be able to kind of look at that.
Any other questions?
All right.
Again.
Thank you.
Thanks to everyone who was online.
Thank you all.